everybody. Happy Valentine's Day to you. Thank you for coming this morning, and we're going to get ready to worship. Hope you enjoy.
Share some with Paul. I got to admit, I had to give lasagna to Paul. It was just so much, and everything was so good. He just didn't tell me there was a chocolate cake involved with that. everything was wonderful. Y'all have been tremendous in the outpouring of emotion and love and prayer and prayer that you've given my family. And on behalf of Lisa and the boys, I just want to thank y'all for that. Before I go any further, not only is this a special day where the world has set aside a day to represent that people that they love through giving of cards and gifts and different accolades, but there's a couple in this church that is very special for them today. And I hope you don't mind by letting me tell you that today is the pastor and his lovely wife's anniversary. And they've been married for 18 years. Arm if you have to. We've got some names to add to it, okay? We need to pray for Shay Hodges for traveling mercies. This will be mentioned again, but Miss Abby Lewandowski is going to have some surgery on the 29th on her knee. We need to start praying for her now. No better time than now. We need to mention the Coker family for bereavement. That's the Coker family. Please pray continuously for Lisa. She's getting better. Brother Danny Gray for help. Our daycare students. Trying to find out there's a lot of that RS something going on. Like talking and carrying on. Like a lot of them's got it over there. So we need to pray for all the students and their families. Miss Linda Landry for help. Miss Uncle Yeoman. We're waving at you. For help. Miss Janet Pickenpaugh. For help. And the B.B. Boyle family for bereavement. It's a lot to write, I know. God can take care of all of it. Amen?
Amen.
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 Right? Amen. Good day. One day closer than we were yesterday.
Yes. Amen.
I've got to think of it like that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, it's an honor to come to you, dear Father, on with Jesus standing between you and I. Dear God, I know he'll make this prayer perfect, even though I may stumble. I might forget to say something, but God, he's going to give it to you perfect. God, I want to thank you first and foremost for being a demonstration of love. God, your people have commercialized it this day. There's no doubt in it. But Lord, with your love, it didn't have no commerciality. Dear God, you gave out of compassion. You gave your one and only and your best, your Son, Jesus Christ. That love displayed upon the cross, dear Father, can't come close to anything that we can buy, anything that we can write, or anything that we could ever say or do for our family or the ones that we love. I pray to the God and the Son who knew no sin but became sin for our name's sake, dear God. We thank you. Dear God, I won't ask you to be my Valentine today, but I only thank you, dear Lord, for being my Savior
and my Lord.
Amen.
And a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. One that operates, dear Father, in the background, that don't want no notoriety, that don't care if Hallmark looks at him or not, that only hearts that are lost come to him. Dear God, we love you. Amen. We don't say that enough, and it can't be no plainer put than we love you. And forgive us, dear Father, when we don't say it. God, today we've come to this place that you've given us, dear God, and it's a place of worship, one that you've given us. But God, it is only that. Dear Father, it is a place that you come together, dear Father, and we have communion with you, dear Christ Jesus. But God, you said, please don't let it stop there. Because God, there is a lost and dying world out there that needs to hear the precious gospel of a precious Savior, who is Jesus Christ. God, convict our hearts of that. Lord, this is not it. This is just a start of it. We need to leave here, dear Father, sharper than when we became in here. We need to leave here, dear Father, more loving than we came in here. We need to be here, dear God, more forgiven than we came in here. I just ask you, dear God, that all the names on the list today, dear Father, are held present in the throne of grace this very day. That the caregivers, dear Father, are given much strength that they need. Let them give hope, dear Father. Let hope shine through your Son, Jesus Christ, to a lost and dying world today, and may it be through us. Dear God, in a few moments, the pastor's going to come. And God, he ain't coming to teach, I don't think. I think he's coming to glorify you. Dear Father, the teaching's already happened in our Sunday school classes. The glorifying needs to happen from this pulpit, this sacred place. I ask you, dear God, to become his thoughts, to become his mind, dear Father, and strip him of anything and everything that he thinks he knows. No pride can be found in him today. I just ask you, dear God, may the Holy Spirit, dear Father, quicken itself in this place and be about us. It's in the name of Christ Jesus that we do pray it. Amen.
you would please stand with us and let's sing our offertory hymn. It's hymn number 138 at Calvary.
His love with the same hands that suffered and bled, giving all that he had to give, a message so easily read. I love you, I love you. That's what Calvary said. I love you, I love you, I love you. How precious is that flow that makes me white as snow? No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. I love you, I love you. That's what Calvary said. I love you, I love you, I love you, written in
Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, St. John, chapter number 3. And I want to look at 3 verses that almost every one of you could leave your Bibles closed and quote them verbatim. John chapter 3, I want to look at verse 16, 17, and 18. While you turn into your places, it's good to have Brother Ben and Haley back. I love that man. He's been with me since the beginning, Paul and Silas. And I can tell you, when somebody that's a fixture, an ornament around the church isn't there, you miss them. And I've missed him the last couple of weeks. And I certainly love he and Lisa and his family. And I'm glad you're back. That's all the time you get off the rest of the year. You've got to be here from now on. That's the 11th commandment. Thou shalt not miss any more church, Bubba, Ben, and Haley. Good to have Miss Linda Johnson with us back there. I can't understand what's going on back there. Tommy's sitting in the lounge chair, and she's sitting in the hard chair with a broke knee. I can't figure that out, but they've been together for a long time, so I guess they've come to an understanding. Amen. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you. From my wife and I, we love you so much. We love our church family. And somebody was walking out the door the other day, and they said, Pastor, we are so blessed to have you. And I thought to myself, my, no, we're blessed to have y'all. And thank you for allowing us to pastor you and minister to you and love you the way that we do. And thank you for loving us the way that you do. There's not a day goes by that my wife and I aren't thankful, and we don't pray, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for bringing us to Wedgefield Baptist Church, the most lovely people in all the world. Amen. Thank you. You got it? John 3:16. Y'all want to stand up? Good-looking crowd today. Got a little hole right there in front of Brother Glenn. You going to fix that for me? Thank you. We got one right here in front of Matthew. You gonna fix that hole we got? All right, but I'm putting you in charge of it. Glenn's a mechanic, he can fix it. The word of the Lord says, how about y'all just quote it with me? Why don't we do that? Are we too formal? We can't change every now and then? We're not, are we? Some churches are so formal and so programized, God couldn't get in if he wanted to. I mean, it's just as stiff. He couldn't get in if he had to. I don't want us to be like that. Let's just all say it together. You ready? We'll say it real slow. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I'll read the rest to you. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now, many times I think we portray God as some mean God who sits up on the throne and all he wants to do is judge and condemn and slap us on the hand every time we do something wrong. And he's like Santa Claus. He's got a list, checking it twice, finding out who's naughty and nice. And he's just sitting up there waiting to whip us. And that's not at all what the Bible teaches. In fact, it's contrary to that. That's not what he says. Because the Bible says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now, there's two categories of people in all the world. This is how we're divided. Red, yellow, black, or white. At the end of the day, we're divided into two lines, and we find them here in verse 18. He that believeth, that's one line. He that believeth on him is not condemned. He's not condemned. There is now, therefore, no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. There's no condemnation. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Thank you. You may be seated. Pray with us, please, now before we begin to bring the message the Lord has laid upon our heart. Would you do that? Pray for your pastor that God would give him the message. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for this lovely day. Thank you for what we celebrate in Valentine's Day and what it represents, Lord, love. And God, we know from your scriptures that God is love. And we're going to talk about that as we go through this service. Lord, you are love. We've never loved before you did. You loved us first before the foundation of the world. You loved people. You loved humanity. You loved human beings. You loved us, and you demonstrated it on Calvary's Hill. Lord, if any one of us should ever doubt whether or not you love us, we should just look at the cross, because there we find the proof, without any doubts, without any reservations, that you indeed love us. And you commended that love toward us when we were unfriendly, when we were disobedient, when we were unlovable, when we were reprobate, when we were rebellious, when we robbed and stole and killed. Lord, when we, in all of our wicked imaginations, did those things deceitful to the word and to the law. Lord, you loved us in spite of us. You loved us anyway. And God, today we celebrate that love. And Father, I believe if we're going to love one another, Lord, we need to draw close to you. And the closer we are to you, the better we'd be able to love one another, to love our spouses, to love our children, to love our families, to love our church. And the further we are from you, the harder it'll be to demonstrate it, to show it, and to say it. So teach us today and help us. If we indeed should celebrate such a day, by all means, God, give us the means wherewith we can. And that's why we preach and pray today in thy name. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ talked to a lot of people during his ministry. All kinds of people, all types of people, people from many different places. But one particular night, recorded in John chapter 3, this person came to him by night. His name was Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a very educated man. He was a very religious man, a well-respected man. He was a Jewish rabbi, and he came to the Lord Jesus Christ. And Nicodemus said unto him, in John chapter 3, verse number 2, it says, Master, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. And then Jesus immediately answered by saying this. He said, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." You remember those verses? Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And so the conversation began between Nicodemus and Jesus about salvation and the new birth and what it all really means. And so Jesus gave a brief summary in John chapter 3, verse 16, of what he was saying to Nicodemus. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Now, I believe that that particular verse is definitely the most popular verse in all of the Bible, the most memorized verse in all of the Bible. I've heard little children, 3 and 4 years old, quote John 3:16. We've got some in our school that can quote it at such a young age. John 3:16, a popular verse. There are 66 books in our Bible. There's 39 in the Old Testament. There's 29 in the New Testament. It makes up 66 books. There's 1,189 chapters in the Word of God. There's 31,102 verses in the King James Bible. And I believe that John 3:16 is a verse that we could take, if that's the only verse that we had, and leave anybody to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. What an amazing verse John chapter 3 is, and verse number 16. They tell me there's 6.5 billion people on the earth, and we can take one verse and it's enough for all 6.5 billion of them, and that's John 3:16. What a wonderful, wonderful verse. Most of us can quote it, as I said, but here's the thing. Here's the thing. We can quote it, but can we understand it? Do we really understand what it's saying to you and I as humanity? And is it necessary? Is it necessary that we should understand it? I think it is. And here's why I think it is. The Bible gives us two great commandments. There's a lot of commandments in the scriptures, but the Bible gives us the two greatest ones in the book of Matthew, chapter number 22. And this is what it says. Jesus said unto them, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart," he's talking to us, "and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind." And that's us. That's who we are. That's the triune being. That's the body. We're to love him with all of our mind, all of our strength, all of our body. We're to love him with all of our soul and all of our spirit. We're to love him. And this is the first and great commandment. That's number one. That's the greatest. But he said the second one is just like it. And this is what it says: "Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." Now, you've heard us say that before. You've heard that verse many times. It's no big thing that I said that to you. But do you remember this part that comes afterwards? It says, "On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." In other words, everything hinges on those two: loving God and loving one another. That's very important. That's a commandment straight from the mouth of Jesus himself. Love the Lord thy God with all of thy mind, with all thy heart, with all thy soul. And love your neighbor as yourself. And it says it's just as important. It's equal. Do you know it's important that you love me? Who is your neighbor? Not the fellow in the brick house to the right. Not the one in the brick house to the left. Those are your neighbors in an earthly sense, and they're neighbors in a spiritual sense. But anybody the Lord puts in your pathway is your neighbor. Anybody you come in contact with. Do you know you got to love me? I don't live beside you, but I'm your neighbor. You got to love me. And I know sometimes I'm unlovable. I'm not pretty to look at, not well to listen to. But you got to love me. You got to put up with me. You got to forbear, because that's what the Bible says. And here's another thought. I got to love you. I got to love you. The Bible commands me to love God and to love you. And certainly as brothers and sisters in Christ, we're to love one another. In fact, one of the evidences of knowing that you're saved is that you love the brethren, that you love one another. Do you love coming to church? Do you love hanging out with us here at Wedgefield Baptist Church? Do you love having little get-togethers and doing little things with one another and talking to one another on the phone and sending one another cards? The Bible says we ought to do that. And one of the evidences, one of the ways that we can know that we're saved, is that we love one another. Now, I'm going to tell you today, I love you. You're looking at a pastor who loves you. I'm here because I love you. I preach because I love you. You may not think it. I may not always prove it. I may not do a good job at demonstrating it. But I tell you where I love you at the best is right here in this pulpit. It's right here in this pulpit, preaching the word of God the way it's written, preaching it for the truth that it is, being honest with you and teaching you how to live a life that's pleasing to God and empowered by God yourselves. Listen, some people think that my wife and I have a direct line to heaven. Well, we do. But here's the thing, so do you. My job is not to teach you how that I can pray for you. My job is to teach you how you can pray for yourself. And if I'm not teaching you that, then I'm making myself a pope, and I'm not him. I'm just an old sinner saved by grace, called to preach the word of God, and that's exactly what I do here. I preach it in love. I preach it in power. I preach it in truth, the way God commanded me to preach it. Why? Because I love you. Amen? I love you best right here. I love you best with this book, and you love me best by praying that God, through this book, would use me to do what he's called me to do. And we certainly do need those prayers. So the way to understand how to love God and the way to understand how to love each other, where do we get that from? Where do we get that knowledge? By understanding first how he loves us. Y'all all right? Y'all are either zoned in completely or you zoned out. I don't know which one it is. Y'all all right? You in here, brother? Say amen if you're here. Amen. Say amen if you're not. Don't dab you back. I got to share five things, and I'm through. I know you got a lot to do today. Some of you got some crooning to do and taking your wife out and all kind of good stuff. I think that's wonderful. Number one, five thoughts. Number one, I want us to notice the source of love. The source of the love that we're talking about today. Our verse starts out in verse 16 about something in my tooth, and I ain't had nothing to eat. The source says, for God. That's how it starts. It starts with him, doesn't it? For God. For God. Does that mean anything to you when the Bible says God? Does it mean anything to you that it's talking about an infinite God, a holy God, a sovereign God, infinite in time? He's from everlasting to everlasting. He's infinite in space. Wherever you go, he's there. He's infinite in wisdom. He knows all things. He's omniscient. He's infinite in power. He's omnipotent. In other words, he has all power in heaven and in earth. He's infinite in his time. He's infinite in space. He's infinite in wisdom and knowledge. He's infinite in his power. And he's infinite in his love. He's infinite in his love for you and for me. Now, there on this earth are many gods that people worship in different religions. But according to the God of this Bible, there's only one God, and that's Jehovah. He is God all by himself. Beside him, there is none other. He is the creator of heaven and earth. He's the creator of life. He's the creator of humanity. It all started with him. We abide, we are sustained in the midst of him. He's behind it all. He backs it up. In him is life. And in him all things were made. The Bible says all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. I'm talking about that God, an infinite God, an eternal God, God creator, God in all of his majesty, God in all of his glory, God who existed when nothing else did, God who sits on the throne and is in control and an authority over everything. I'm talking about that God, for God. It started with that God who always has been, who is, and who always will be. That God, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, from eternity past to eternity forward, that God, for God. Y'all know who I'm talking about. And when you read the Word of God, here's the thing. Here's the chief characteristics of that God. Here it is. Y'all all right? God is love. That's the chief characteristics of this eternal, infinite, amazing God. 1 John 4:7-8. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God. And here it is, for God is love. He's the one doing the loving. He's the one who loved us before we loved him. Before the foundations of the world, he loved us. Why? Because that's who he is. He is love. He created us because he loves us, and he wants to have an intimate, personal, up-close relationship with us, fellowship with us, to walk with us and talk with us, to be with us, because he loves us. He always has loved you. He always will love you infinitely. He can't help it, because he is. Isn't it a wonderful thought, Brother Marvin, that Jesus loves you and that God loves you? Isn't it a wonderful thought, Miss Marilyn, that God loves you? Miss Joy, isn't it a wonderful thought? It's a wonderful thought. She got 2 dozen roses last week. We had a conversation about that too. 2 dozen, Becky. That's 24, ain't it? 12 and 12 is 24. You got 24 roses from her husband. That's wonderful. Good job, John. That's wonderful. Isn't it wonderful to know that John loves you? That little baby you holding loves you. I've seen him goo-goo and gaga at you. But isn't it wonderful to think that God of all creation, in all of his majesty and might and sovereign power, that he would look down at old sinful men like us, and in his heart of hearts have no choice. He's got to can't help it but to love us. Isn't that wonderful? For God, that's where it started. Number two, let's look at the character of God's love. For God so loved. Now, there's 3 words that you find in the Bible in the Greek that represent the word love as we say it in English. One of those words is eros. Eros. That's love. It means love, but it's a different kind of love. It means a fleshly love. A fleshly kind of love. In other words, if I said I love Paula Tedder's ooey gooey cake, that's fleshly love. I love her ooey gooey. That's my new favorite. And I went to the diabetic doctor this week, and she said, no ooey gooey. And she's her last name is Shong, so she's Japanese or something, and she don't talk right. I said, I can't understand a word you're saying. What'd you say? No ooey gooey. What if I take extra pill? No ooey gooey. But eros, it's a fleshly kind of love. I love Miss Lydia's chocolate delight cake. That's good. I love Miss Linda's banana pudding. You know, I love my wife's spaghetti or whatever. You know, that's what it's talking about. But then there's another word, and it's called philios. And that's a little bit stronger love. That's the kind of love we understand as a family. I love my wife. That's philios. That's a human kind of love. Or I love my mom and I love my daddy. I love my children. I love you. That's philios. That's a little deeper love, but it's kind of family type love that we understand as family. So those two kind of words, they're an intense affection for one another or on another based on feelings and emotions that we have. And the thing about those feelings and emotions is that they can change. They can change from day to day. Men and women who love one another, they fall out of love. Parents who love their children when they turn teenagers, they don't love them no more. That's philios. It can change. Just kidding, teenagers. We love you. We do love you. That's a joke. Don't go tell anybody. But that's a different kind. And then there's another kind of love And you remember we went through this thing, this agape love. They killed it. They just blew it out. I mean, it didn't make any sense. It was agape. Everything was agape. You got buses riding around town, agape this and agape that. There's no comparison to agape love. That's a spiritual love. That's a deeper love. That's the kind of love that God has for you and I. What's the difference with eros, philios, and agape? Eros and philios is conditional. What do I got to do to make you love me? Y'all right? Agape is unconditional. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter where you've been. You can't change it. It's unconditional. You know what unconditional means? No condition. In other words, when you fell in love with your spouse, there had to be some conditions. There had to be something that attracted you to them, something that you liked, something that you needed, something that you desired. There was something, wasn't it? You didn't marry a mule. You married a woman, or you married a man. You married somebody that met some conditions, right? Hunting land, a boat motor. Boat in a boat, moat in a pond, stocked with brimming bass. Amen. Listen, amen. I talk about fishing, boy. Everybody shouts. But God's love is unconditional. It's not based on conditions. That's good to know, isn't it? Because I can tell you what, I haven't been so lovely. Let me give you some proof. 1 John 4:10. 1 John 4:10. Herein is love. Not that we loved God, because we didn't, but that he loved us and sent his son to be a propitiation for our sins. What does propitiation mean, Pastor? Propitiation is the act of God whereby he sees the blood of Jesus as completely satisfying for the atonement and payment for sin. That's what it is. We didn't love him. He loved us. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. That's propitiation. The act whereby Christ shed his blood as an atoning work for our sins, to blot them out, to get them out of the way, to keep us from being separated from God to begin with. He was willing to do that. That's agape love. He so loved. Have you ever loved anybody enough to go hang on the cross? Have we ever loved anybody to go be beaten and stricken and smitten with a cat of nine tails and having the flesh ripped from our bones? Have we ever loved anybody so much that we'd be willing to die for them in the manner that Christ died for us? He was bruised for our iniquities. How's it go? I went blank. He was wounded for our transgressions. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. You ever been willing to shed your blood for somebody the way he did? Not just somebody. The Bible talks about, hey, it may be likely that one would die for his mom or dad or children. I may would die for my family, my wife. I may would die for you. But listen, when he died on the cross, he died for the enemy. He died for the rebellious. He died for the fornicator. He died for the murderer. He died for the sins of the whole world, past, present, and future. Have we ever loved anybody so much we'd be willing to lay down our life? Listen, it doesn't matter what you've done, where you've been, who you are. It's unconditional. No conditions have to be met before God will be willing to save us. Some people say, here, listen. Some people say, oh, I love God. I love God, and we think it's a big deal, don't we? We think it's a big favor that we're doing for him. That's not the big deal, folks. That's not the big deal. We ought to love him. He is love. He's lovable. There's nothing that should keep us from loving him. He's a lovable God. He is love. Here's the big deal. The big thing is that he loves us. That's the big thing. The big deal is that he loves us. He knows us thoroughly. He loves us throughly. I don't think it's a word, but it sounds good. But he loves us through and through. He loves us and knows us completely and loves us anyway. Isn't that wonderful? For God so loved. Number three, the object of God's love. Who is the object of God's love? Let me tell you what it's not. For God so loved the world. Now, he created all things, and I'm sure he's pleased with it because the Bible says so, doesn't it? In the book of Genesis. And he was pleased with it. But it's not talking about the birds flying in the air. It says, for God so loved the world. Not agape. He doesn't love the trees and the bees and the mosquitoes. And when it says world here, the world means earth. He loves humanity. He loves mankind, for God so loved mankind, and it encompasses every human being that's ever been born. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You remember that song, Whosoever Meaneth Me? Can you believe God loves you? Can you believe God loves me? He loves everybody the same, red, yellow, black, and white. They're all precious in his sight. He loves the whole world. For the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Why? Because he loves all of us. For God so loved the world, it represents all and encompasses all of humanity. For God so loved the world. He loves the educated. He loves the uneducated. He loves the rich. He loves the poor. He loves the pretty. He loves the ugly. He loves the big. He loves the small. He loves us all, the young and the old alike. He loves us all. We're included. I'm trying to tell you, God loved the world. Amen. God loves you. Regardless of where you are in any situation, God loves you. So now we get into the good stuff. I'm glad I didn't stop there. For God so loved the world, you and I, what did it do? There's the gift of God's love that he gave his only begotten son. That he gave his only begotten son. Here's the gift that surpasses all other gifts. Here's the greatest gift that's ever been given. Here's the gift that we cannot afford. The pearl of great price. Heaven's jewel, heaven's treasure, God's most precious, precious gift was given to you and I. The Lord did not give us something. Mark this down somewhere in your Bible. The Lord didn't give us something. He gave us somebody. And his name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, heaven's pearl of great price. He gave him to us to become a sacrifice. Deity in flesh, becoming the supreme sacrifice for the sin of humanity and the separation of God through our sins, offers his life for us. Jesus died. Jesus died. Does that do anything in your heart that God became a man and he dwelt upon this earth as humanity and he died on a rugged cross? He died on a borrowed cross, was buried in a buried tomb, a borrowed tomb. Avis Christensen in 1920, sweet dear lady of God, I believe she got a glimpse of it. And she wrote this song. Up Calvary's mountain, one dreadful morn, walked Christ my Savior, weary and worn, facing for sinners death on the cross, that he might save them from endless loss. And this is how it goes. Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, blind and unheeding, dying for me. Amen. The gift of God's love. The gift of God's love. Someone wrote, could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Infinite, infinite, everlasting, eternal love. And number five in closing, the purpose of God's love. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You see, he never wanted us to be separated. He created us to have fellowship with him. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. We were created to fellowship with him, and so he had to buy us back from sin. And the only thing that would qualify was the precious blood of Jesus Christ. The works of the cross had to be in place in order for you and I to have atonement and redemption. Nothing else would satisfy him. In the Old Testament, we see priests, high priests going every year and picking out a lamb without spot and blemish and shedding his blood and taking it to the mercy seat and laying it on the mercy seat and spreading it on the mercy seat for the sin of the people for a year. But those sacrifices, although they were done as an act of obedience in God, were never meant to sanctify anybody or save anybody or forgive anybody. They never worked. That's why they had to do them every year. But Jesus Christ came once and for all and became the supreme sacrifice, the only thing, the only one, the only person that would qualify as redemption's work. You see, he's the propitiation of our sin. And the purpose, listen, is because he loved us. So here's the thing. When life is over and there's only two possible destinies, we either perish, and that means separated from his presence, or we have everlasting and eternal life in his presence. There are no other destinations. There's no such thing as annihilation. In other words, like some animal will just cease to exist. That never happens to humans. We always exist. Remember, we are triune being. We are soul, body, spirit. When our body goes to the graves and the worms eat it and we turn back into dust to dust, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, whatever. Listen, our soul continues to exist. It either exists in heaven or it exists in hell. And I told you I was going to preach on that today, but I wasn't very comfortable with it because it's Valentine's Day and I wasn't thinking about that last week, so we'll get to that next week. Today we're talking about God's love. But listen, he has done everything necessary for you and I to be in his presence. He could do absolutely nothing else. He has done everything he could do so that you and I would qualify, so that we would be redeemed and be in his presence. He did it. Why? Because he loves us, and so that we would have everlasting and eternal life. Does that make sense? Well, here's the thing. Here's the thing. If I were to ask you to raise your hands, every one of you, unless you was something wrong with you, every one of them would say, I want to have everlasting and eternal life. I don't want to perish. I don't want to live separated from God. I don't want to live under condemnation. Somebody's got to pay for your sins. Either you got to pay for it or you got to trust him. And that's what he did on the cross. And we have to accept him. So the way that we have everlasting life, the way we don't perish, is that we come to him by faith and we trust what he did on the cross, the finished works at Calvary, by faith. For by grace are you saved through faith. And I've had people to tell me before, y'all all right? I hadn't even gone over today, have I? Praise God. Cheers. But I hear people say to me, I don't have enough faith to be saved. There's nowhere in the Bible that ever says how much faith it takes to be saved. Nobody has a lot of faith when they first get saved. Because if you know the means from where faith comes, nobody who first gets saved has a whole lot of faith. It doesn't take a whole lot of faith. You can take a little bit of faith and get a great big Savior. You take whatever faith you have and you put it in the finished works of Jesus Christ and you'll have everlasting and eternal life. You see? You say, well, preacher, some people say, I've been too bad. There's no such thing. That'd be like somebody saying, I've been too good. There's no such thing. It isn't about good or bad and which one outweighs the other. That's not what it's about. Because the matter of fact is, there are no good people. The Bible says there is none good, no, not one. There is none righteous. There's none that doeth good. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That scale that we're weighing our good versus our evil, and we got our fingers crossed hoping that when God comes back or we quit breathing that our good outweighs the bad, that does not exist in the Bible. That philosophy, that teaching, that theology is straight from hell. It don't exist. What determines where we'll go is not determined by good or bad. It's determined by what we believe about Jesus Christ. It's not what you've done. It's what he did. It's not who I am. It's who he is. That's what it's based upon. And he tells us over and 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 over that he loves us. If you ever doubt that God loves you, look at that cross, because he left an eternal imprint on our hearts. Every time you look at the cross and every time you doubt, just look at the cross and this is what he says. I love you this much. I love you so much that I'd rather die, and I'd die again if I have to, but I don't because it's finished, but I'd die again, and if you were the only one, I'd die for you. I love you this much. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Started out with two great commandments. The first one is to love God with all you got. Cannot do it until we understand how much he loves us. Second thing I said was to love your neighbor. It says it's equal to the first one, love your neighbor as yourself. Cannot do it until we understand how much he loves us. We cannot be obedient to those two commandments without having a glimpse of how much he loves us. You all right? Considering everything I've said so far, this is what God says. You need to love me like that. And we can do that. He's lovable. Then he tells us to love each other like that. And guess what? We're not so lovable. Not all the time. We have our moments. We have our moods. We have our days. We have some days we're sweet. We have some days we're sour. Don't look at me like you don't. You lie. Kobe says, this is what Kobe says around the house. You lie, your breath stinks, and you don't love Jesus. Hey, listen, we all have our ways, don't we? You know the Bible, you know what, listen, B.B. Ball, he's not a whole lot older than I am. Wonderful, wonderful man of God, great, great preacher, good friend of my family's. Wonderful preacher. He ain't a whole lot older than I am, is he? He passed away. I don't know why he passed away. We haven't heard yet. But I heard no preacher say one time that most pastors die from a broken heart. You know the thing that kills people like me? You know the thing that makes us tired and makes us weary? Makes us want to do something different sometimes? You know the thing is when God's people walk around angry at one another. And they don't love one another. It hurts us more than anything else in Christendom is when believers don't love one another, when brothers and sisters are at odds and they're angry. The Bible says, be angry and sin not. How do you do that? How do you be angry and sin not? You do it the way Jesus did it. You get angry at the sin, not the sinner. Because the Bible says we are to love one another. I'm going to read it to you. 1 John 4:11, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. Huh? We ought to love one another. We need to love one another. We have to love one another. Why are we so quick to condemn each other? God didn't condemn you. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now you reject his Son, he will condemn you. But that's not why he came. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. That's why he came. Y'all all right? Condemnation. Listen, condemnation between believers is never correct. You have no right, ma'am, to get mad at that lady over there. Nothing in the Bible permits it. Sir, you have no right to be mad at that gentleman over there. Well, he didn't speak to me. Get over it. You walked by me and didn't speak. I ain't talking to nobody. I'm just using this. Y'all beat me up. Don't be beating on me after church. You see what I'm trying to say? We walk around mad because we didn't do what you thought we should do. And whoever meets all those credentials, we all make mistakes. We all forget. We all fail. But nothing in the Word of God gives us the right to condemn our brothers and sisters in Christ. We're to love one another the way God loved us. And I just explained it to you the best I know how, at how he loves us. So how do we do that? How would we ever be able to love one another? First thing is we gotta understand how he loves us. 1 John 4:7, beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. We have a Valentine banquet at 6 o'clock. You know why? We having steak. We having chicken. We having pork loin. What else we have? Baked potato. Salad, bread, banana pudding, ooey gooey. You know why we're doing that? To promote loving one another. Yesterday morning, Miss Charlotte had the women's ministry meeting back here. And I waited for my wife to call me at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. And then Fanatics is back here. You know what they was doing? Loving on one another. And it's okay. It's okay. You know why God created the church? He instituted the church. He don't need church. For you and I. to come in and encourage one another, to edify one another, to do like he does, to love one another. He said, love me. How, Father? The way I loved you. Love one another. How, Father? The way I loved you. Hey, Mr. Husband, how are you to love your wife? As God loved the church and gave himself for it. Ma'am, how are you to love your husband the way God loved you? Children, how are you to love your parents the way God loved you? Parents, how are you to love your children the way God loved you? I tell people when I counsel them in marriage, the nearer we are to God, the nearer we'll be to one another. And the further we are from God, the further we'll be from one another. Because God is love. And he says, I want you to love me that way. And I want you to love my creation that way. All my little girls and all my little boys that I created, I want you to love them the way I did. You know what we are? Reflectors. All of us are little lights. And you know what we ought to be reflecting? Not anger, not bitterness, not jealousy, not hatred. We ought to be reflecting the love of God so that others can see it in us and turn to worship him. Are you reflecting his light toward him? Are you reflecting it toward others, toward your spouse, toward your children? Today's Valentine's Day. Let each other know how much you love each other. Daddy, don't be so hard, calloused. Stoop down on one knee and tell your wife you love her and you're thankful for the day that you married her. Stoop down before your children and tell them they're the greatest gift that God's ever given besides Jesus. Tell them you love them. Kids, listen. Whatever you're doing, just for a little while, go hug mom around the neck and tell her you love her. Go hug your daddy. Say, Dad, I thank God. I got a note on my mirror at home that Lydia wrote me. It's a little square note like this, and it's taped to my window. And it says, Daddy, I am so blessed to have you as my father. I love you. That's what it's about. That's what Valentine's Day is all about. I don't know who he was. I don't give a flip, but I know who he is. And I love my wife, and I love my mama and my daddy, and I love my children, and I love my friends, and I love you. And I can't do it because it's Valentine's Day. I do it because God is love. And I want everybody to see it in my life every day. I love you. I love you. Happy Valentine's Day. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Jesus came to this earth to save us. He came to save us because he loved us. He loves us because he created us for himself. When we by faith come to him, realizing that we're sinners separated, realizing that he's the only thing that can restore that relationship, we come to him and say, God, I've sinned, and I need you to save me. By faith, the Bible says, in that moment we pass from death to life. How many of you raise your hands today? Say, I know Jesus loves me, and I know he's my Savior. Would you raise your hand? Look at that, isn't that wonderful? Thank you. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I've never been saved. I never knew his part. But today you said something that got to me. Today you said something that told me the old story. How that Jesus came as God's gift. sacrificed himself on my behalf so that I could be saved. Is there anyone like that would raise their hand and say, Pastor, I've never been saved? Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I think I'm saved, but I'm not 100% sure. I have doubts, I have fears, and I want to know that I'm saved. Listen, I'm not going to come get you and bring you up here and embarrass you. I never do that. Never do that. I want to pray for you. Would you raise your hand? Just be honest. Nobody's looking. Every head bowed. Nobody looking around. This is an intimate moment. Nobody needs to see but me and the Lord. Nobody looking. You raise your hand and say, Pastor, I don't have assurance that I'm saved, and I want you to pray for me. Thank you, sir. God didn't come down on the cross for you to doubt. He comes so that you could know all of God's children. And you can know. And I'm going to pray right now that God will give you assurance. And I want you to know I'm always here to take the Bible and lead you and show you how you can have the blessed assurance that Jesus is Lord. Father, you've seen every hand. Lord, more importantly, you've seen every heart. Come today, would you please come?